So in chapters 3 and 4, we talked about Mendelian inheritance, Mendelian genetics. Now in chapter 5, what we're going to do is we're still going to talk about Mendelian genetics, but we're going to do it from a chromosomal perspective or basis.
Sort of to the cellular level and look at a lot of, and look at similar things, but then do it this time from a chromosomal perspective. So as you can see, in a lot of the topics that we're talking about or that we're discussing, we're kind of discussing it from a bunch of different angles, from a bunch of different perspectives, and from a bunch of different layers, right? We're looking at these alleles and things symbolically, doing these calculations. We're going to look at it from a molecular level. We're going to look at it from a chromosomal level. The reason the book does this is because genetics is, you know, this topic that it's a topic that has lots and lots of subtopics, and one of the main sort of pushes of this book is to get you to understand these genetics, to kind of synthesize all these different perspectives into this broad understanding of genetics. And so that's what this chapter is about. This chapter is about chromosomes. And so we'll go through, and part of it will be review stuff, and you know, most of you know what chromosomes are, most of you know what chromosomes are made up of, etc., etc. And then we're going to, you know, do a discussion on chromosomal theory, and its theory in the scientific sense of the theory. We'll talk about that. And then we'll have a large part of it here, and sort of the problem set part of it is going to be discussing or looking at sex-linked traits. You're going to be happy when we get to these problems, because after chapter 3 and chapter 4, you're going to start doing these sex-linked problems. And you're going to say, oh man, these are, you know, it's just a little bit different because you have to, you know, keep track of the XY chromosome or whatever. But you're going to say, oh yeah, this is easy compared to last chapter. And then we'll talk about some sort of biochemical or cellular things that go on to compensate for chromosomes or our sex chromosomes at the very end of the chapter. Okay. So chromosomes, each species has a... characteristic set of chromosomes. What is this called? We have a term for this. This genome is kind of the whole... I heard genome. Is that you? Genome is kind of all of our genes, all of our genetic material. All of our chromosomes have a different name. We call that a karyotype. So humans have a specific... quote-unquote, normal karyotype, right? How many chromosomes is the normal number of humans? Anybody know? 23 different kinds, right? And how many? We have one kind, one number one chromosome from our father, one number one chromosome from our mother, so we have 46 total. Okay. There are some sort of vocabulary words that you need to know. We've talked about some of these already. You've probably talked about all of these in previous classes, maybe in 11 or 10. Well, certainly if you've had cell, you've talked about these. But these are just some terms that you need to know. Chromatin, euchromatin, heterochromatin, those might be new to you. Haploid and diploid, we've talked about before, right? There's certain organisms, organisms have haploid and diploid stages, right? Do humans have a haploid and diploid stage? Yeah, there's a haploid stage is when we're gametes, right? Separate gametes. All of a sudden, the gametes fuse, we become a diploid. When we say diploid, we mean two sets or two copies of each chromosome. Haploid just means one copy of each chromosome. And so we symbolize the haploid with the haploid number with the letter N. We symbolize the diploid number the letter 2 in. We see also that there are other organisms that have multiple copies of these different chromosomes. And so in humans we have N, our haploid number, haploid meaning the different kinds of chromosomes, chromosome 1 to 22 plus the sex chromosomes, and so our haploid number is 23. Our diploid number, the number that the vast majority of our cells have, the number of chromosomes that are cells have, is 2 times 23 or 46. But we see, especially in plants, and especially agricultural plants, we have organisms that are tetraploid and octoploid, and even, you know, other combinations of that. What does that mean? Tetra means four. Tetraploid means there's four copies of each chromosome. And we'll talk about maybe some advantages that gives us. Euchromatin, if we look at the chromatin, right? Chromatin is basically, we'll talk about it here in a second, but chromatin is basically the stuff that the chromosomes are made of. If we look at it, we see that there are lighter stained areas and darker stained areas. The lighter stained areas is where we have active transcription going on. We've talked about transcription, but I'm sure you talked about transcription before. Transcription is where you're converting the DNA information, right? Where you're transcribing the DNA into mRNA, right? So there's active copying of genes going on. The darker areas are what we call the heterochromatin. Okay. So, this is what it looks like. Here's the lighter area, right? So this is where active transcription is happening. Here's the heterochromatin. This is where the darker area where it's not actively going on. It makes sense. Why would this area be darker? Why would this area be lighter?
Still wound up, dense.
Yeah. So here, good Chris. So here, the heterochromatin is going to be wound up, right? We're going to have this tight association. We'll look at the association here in a second. The association between the DNA and the protein is going to be tight, so you're not going to have access to that DNA. You need to get access to the DNA here, so it has to open up so that you can get all of the enzymes machinery in there to make those copies of the DNA. Okay, and here's just a new report. So that's kind of what the heterochromatin and euchromatin looks like. I just want you to know the difference between those two. Okay. So, all eukaryotic cells store genetic information in chromosomes. Most eukaryotic cells have anywhere between 10 and 50 chromosomes in their bodies. We humans, we're not the most complex. We don't have the most chromosomes. We have 46, like I mentioned before. Chromosomes are made up of protein and DNA. So in the beginning, we realized this. We understood that that chromosomes are made up of nucleic acids and proteins long before we actually understood exactly how these things were being coded for or which of these two substances was actually encoding the information. Maya? There's some plants that have like hundreds. I mean, there's some that have a lot more than this. Yeah. There's even a mold that has one. Hold on, Maya. There's a slide here in a second that gives a whole bunch of the numbers. And so we'll look for the ones that specifically have more than humans. It took us a long time to figure out that it actually was the DNA that was coding for the information because our bias as scientists before this time was that it has to be protein because protein is more complex, right? If you think of amino acids, if you compare amino acids to nucleic acids, how many different combinations of amino acids did you get with the same sort of units that you could with DNA? We could do that now, right? Because we know our probability stuff. So if you had to do that, how would you calculate it? So this is all the new skills that we're learning. So how would you do it? So let's just pretend we don't know any different. We now know that the units of information come in threes, right? Let's just say we didn't know that. Let's say they came in fours. And so each four, either acid or each four nucleotide, could code for a bit of the information, and then this is our hypothesized what we now call codon, right? If we were to look at DNA, right, and figure out how many different combinations of the nucleotides could those four spaces code for, how would we do it? How do you figure out those combinations? Or the potential combinations? How many nucleic acids do you have in this first space?
One of four.
Four, right? One out of four. How many do you have here? Four. If you can have repeated nucleic acids in each of those, you can figure out the total number of combinations, total number of distinct informational units. Out of that, all you do is times those together, right? So 4, 16, 64, what, 256?
Yeah.
Yep.
256. So that's a whole bunch, right? You might say, okay, that's a fair amount. But if you compare that to amino acids, let's just say essential, make it easy, essential amino acids.
20.
How many amino acids we have?
It's 20.
Let's say 20.
Basically.
20, yeah, basically 20, 20, 20. And then if I calculate 20 times 20 times 20 times 20, what? Something to the degrees.
160,000.
160,000?
Yeah.
So 160,000. So this is how many informational units that would code for the protein. So obviously, if you're a scientist during that day, you'd be like, look how complicated the world is out there. You go, you walk down a trail, and you see all these different animals, different plants. There's a massive amount of biological variation. So obviously, it has to be protein, right? But you have to code for that information. And so that was the bias of the researchers at the time. They just thought, oh, it has to be the protein. We knew it was either the nucleic acid or the protein. And so it took us a long, long time to overcome that bias towards thinking it was protein, and then finally discovered that it was actually the DNA. Okay, so a karyotype, again, is just an individual's particular array of chromosomes. So let's look at some karyotypes. Oh, yeah, so sorry. From chapter 2, just a reminder of the slide that we had in chapter 2. This is the association of the DNA, the double helix, with the histine proteins, right? You have the histine proteins that wrap the DNA that coils. They can talk about spone cords, right? Looks like these spone cords wrapped around the histine proteins, wrapped around again, coiled to a second layer and a third layer. Once you get down to this depiction, this common depiction that we have it for a chromosome, you can see that the DNA is really tightly nestled in there, and that you're not going to have access in this form to that DNA. And so this is when it's all wrapped up, tightly compacted, and the chromosome is getting ready to go through mitosis, right? You have to sort of disassemble all of this to get access to the DNA. That's what's happening with transcription. That's why the U chromatin is like, just a reminder, what we're looking at at a study. Okay, so this is... So if you see here, these are the haploid numbers. So human beings here, Homo sapiens, haploid number 23. You have chimpanzees, have haploid number 24. You have domestic cats, 36. Chickens, 39. Fish, or kind of fish, that sucks. You see it? I'm not sure what that is. 25 here, Xenophis labius. This is that frog we're talking about, right? Can we talk about that first year?
You got cloned, I got cloned, right?
Yeah, clone frog had 17. We had out here wheat 21. We'll talk more about exactly where we've actually recreated this genome. But you can see here that there's a lot of variation in the number of haploid numbers and a lot of variation in the number of chromosomes. What do you notice about this? We've talked about a bunch of these organisms before, right? So, for instance, in chapter 1, talk about some of the model organisms. What do you notice about these model organisms? See, here's C. elegans. Talk a little bit about C. elegans. What's its haploid number?
Six.
Right? What's another? You see the other? Remember the plant? Or Arabidopsis? Five.
Fruit fly has four.
That's another one. Any others? Oh, yeah, the baker's yeast. That is 16. What do you notice about a trend? What tends to happen with the model organisms?
They're all lower.
Yeah, they're all lower. Why is that?
Easier to study.
Yeah. Good, exactly. It's easier to understand, right? You want to start with the simple stuff. Of course, you have to get, as you know, our sort of ultimate goal, quote unquote, is to get to understand the human, not our ultimate goal, but our main goal is to understand the human system. And so as we get closer to it, so like, for instance, with the mice, it's not as simple as a genome, but when we only have a few chromosomes, or we have a fewer number of chromosomes, it it's easier to track what's going on. And so that's one of the reasons here with the fruit fly. We'll talk about Thomas H. Morgan and his experiments with the fruit fly, but that was one of the reasons that the fruit fly was used as a model organism, as well as other reasons that we talked about. Remember when we were selecting model organisms, what are the criteria we always like to look for? Mass reproduction, be able to do it in the lab, right? We'll talk specifically more about when we're trying to link a mutation, a physical mutation, with a distinguishable morphology of the chromosome, why fruit flies are important for that too. Okay, so let's talk about a little bit about variation in sex chromosomes. And so if we're all fairly familiar with how sex is determined, more or less, we'll talk more about this too, in humans, but in a general sense, we know that if you have two X chromosomes, you're female. If you have an X and a Y chromosome, you're male. We're going to talk about where this isn't exactly. It's more complicated than that, but you know, just in general, we're all pretty familiar with that. When we look at other organisms, though, we find that there are other systems out there. This isn't this universally applicable system of an XY chromosome, you know, a big X chromosome, and kind of a puny Y chromosome. If we look at grasshoppers, we actually find that females have two X chromosomes, and males have one X chromosome and no Y chromosome. So females actually have one more chromosome than the males. And so here you have, was that going to change your sex ratio? What do you think? How is that going to work on a cellular level? So you have a female, XX, right? And you have a male that just has an X, which, just to keep a space, we say, oh, it just doesn't have one. When a male is producing gametes, what are the gametes that it's going to be producing? Yeah, some of them, have that X chromosome, some of them will not. Okay. You think that could have potential impact on fertilization rates or not? You know, if the sperm are moving and they're using lighter, they can move quicker. So there could be implications there, right? Females are going to produce eggs, right? All of the eggs are going to have an X chromosome. If this sperm fertilizes that egg, you're going to get what?
Male.
If this sperm fertilizes that egg, and so the end result of the grasshopper system is the same, right? You pretty much have a 50-50 ratio. I looked at the research that recently, like 10 years ago or so, there were a bunch of papers that were coming out that talked about the disappearing Y chromosome in humans. It's kind of getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And eventually, you know, it may disappear altogether because there's not that many. We'll look at some of the genes that are on the Y chromosome, but there's really not that many Y chromosomes. So, our Y chromosomes are becoming obsolete. Okay, so here is that grasshopper exosystem. There's the human system at the top. We see in chickens we have a different system called a ZGZW. Basically, the difference is that the males in this case have the homozygous chromosomes, so the ZZ, which is the equivalent in humans would be the XX, right? The females have the different chromosomes, so this would be like the XY in humans, but here it's the ZW. Okay. We see in eusocial insects too a very interesting way of determining gender, and that is what we call a haplodiploidy system. We're haploid, so if you have an egg that doesn't get fertilized, it develops into one of the sexes. If you have an egg that does get fertilized, it develops into the other sex. So in a lot of these haploid diploid systems, you have males that are haploid, so the haploid number is 16, they only have one copy of each gene. You have diploids, the females are diploids, they have two copies of each of those genes. So we have a lot of variation in how sex is determined. In the lizard species, the mesquite lizard in Mexico that I study, you have an even more complicated system. You actually have four sex chromosomes. So your females will be have an X1, X2 chromosome, and then, well, in the updating mother, so in females, what you have is you have two sets of each of those X chromosomes. So female would have an X1, X2. So female actually has four sets of chromosomes. Males, on the other hand, would have an X1, X2, and a Y. So males have one less chromosome than the females. So how in meiosis, how do you think those things get inherited? Like, you think they have issues with it? It's kind of a weird system because you could have potentially a bunch of different combinations, right? What ends up happening though is these two chromosomes, even though they're separate chromosomes, they act as a single unit. And so all of the eggs. In males, they'll act as, again, it's kind of a single unit and a single unit. So essentially, it ends up being the same sort of system as humans, but you have these chromosomes that are split, but that are inherited as a unit. And so that's a little bit weird. But what it actually does in these lizards is it makes it so that the males and the females have different chromosomes, but also in this species, which we'll talk about a little bit more when we start talking about unbalanced number of chromosomes, you have different populations. One population, it's called the standard chromosomal race, has 32 chromosomes. Well, this is the female number. 32 chromosomes. You go, you know, where the standards are around Mexico City. You go outside of Mexico City into the state of Querétaro. You have populations that have 34 chromosomes. You then go down into over to Hidalgo, and you have populations that have 36, then 38. You go down into Puebla, you have populations that have all the way up to 46 chromosomes. So massive amount of variation. The lizards look the same. This is kind of what they look like. Look like the lizards we have here, right? If they ever caught blue bellies when they were young in southern Utah. Same genus, Glauchoris genus. We have four species here. Very similar, come with that same way. They run throughout Mexico, and morphologically, they look very, you know, very similar. You look at their chromosomes, and you have a massive amount of variation. So it's interesting in how they deal with that. So you think, oh, well, maybe we're just seeing that they all look the same. But if you have a different number of chromosomes, that's probably because you're a separate species, right? I mean, how well do humans adapt to a different number of chromosomes in their karyotypes? Do we have cases where we have examples of adaptation or have an unbalanced amount? What are they? What's the classic one? Down syndrome, right? Trisomy 21. Do we have an extra number 21 chromosome? Do we have cases where we have a trisomy number 1? What do we call it? There probably are cases, but we don't call it anything. How about trisomy 2? No, trisomy 3? No, there's only a handful of...
Your sex chromosomes are...
Yeah, so if you have an unbalanced, so let's say you have only one X chromosome, we call that Turner syndrome. We have another one called Tah syndrome. We'll talk about those. But we don't have very many cases. Why is that? Think about the number one chromosome. How do we name chromosomes?
Their size.
Their size. So number one, this massive chromosome probably has a lot of genes on it. We have an imbalance in that, what probably happens to that fertilized egg?
Lethal mutation.
Yeah, spontaneously aborted. Mm-hmm. So we can't handle that very well. And in fact, probably the best case scenario is trisomy 21, where we can't handle it. You know, you can still, you know, you can still survive. And you can still, you know, yes, there's a suite of morphological characteristics that occur with trisomy 21, but it's probably the best case scenario of all of them, right? Because they don't. It's spontaneously aborted. And so humans can't handle that. How on earth are the lizards able to have massive amounts of variation in this? And in fact, if you take a lizard from this is the 46, we call it multiple take a lizard from a population with 46, you can actually mate it with a lizard from a population with 32, and you get this hybrid intermediate. So they actually can mate with
lizards. Is it fertile? Is that?
And it's fertile. There have been a bunch of different studies that where there may be some indication of a little bit less fertile in some cases, but then the hybrid zones where this intermixing is happening are very narrow. And so it's kind of this weird situation. It's almost like this window of speciation. It seems like they should be tending to separate out, but for some reason they're able to adapt to it. And so the point is that there's lots and lots of variation in chromosome numbers. There's lots and lots of variation in how different organisms do these things. And so that's part of, you know, why we're talking about this, so that you can understand the variation that is out there. Okay, so sex chromosome in humans, again, XX, or females, XY, or males, during meiosis, the X and the Y chromosomes pair, then they separate out. If the chromosome is important in determining gender, we call it the sex chromosomes. If it's not, we call it autosomes. You all probably know this for you. Okay. Here is just a depiction of the X and the Y chromosome on these end regions, these terminal regions, we call telomeres. In telomeres, we have a lot of repetitive sequence. Telomeres, we talked about before, have to do with, we're seeing more and more that it has to do with things like cancer, with immunity, with aging, and things like that. And in fact, we talked about it before. Somebody sent me a paper, and I kept the paper because I wanted to. Who was it?
The one on the
telomere. Did you get it, Christian? Yeah. So Christian gave me a really nice paper, and I said, "All right, I'm going to keep this, and I'm going to post it when we get back to it." So I'm going to post on Canvas this really nice paper about telomeres that I want you to read. You know, it's sort of a leisurely one. We'll discuss it a little bit, but it's a pretty interesting topic. So I'll post that this week. If we look at sex ratios, so theoretically when we're looking at the XY chromosomes, theoretically when we deal with meiosis, we say, okay, those chromosomes are going to segregate at a 50-50 ratio, right? So therefore, you will have, you know, if we had to do these problems, we would separate out the, you know, we could make a Punnett square with the two X chromosomes and the XY chromosomes, expect a 50-50 ratio. In reality, we don't get a 50-50 ratio. When we look at fertilized eggs, we call this the zygotic sex ratio, we actually see that the ratio is pretty skewed. It's not a 1-to-1 ratio, it's a 1.3-to-1 ratio. More males than females, 1.3 males to every one female. If we follow that along through through birth in humans, we see that there's a reduction in the number of males. The new ratio is 1.07-to-1. So what is that telling us? Which gender tends to survive better the pregnancy?
Males.
Females are surviving better, right? Males, we have a whole bunch of them, but they're, you know, less caution. I don't know. They don't survive as well. If we then look at the sex ratio at age of reproduction, which is the important one, right, for maintaining, from an evolutionary perspective, for maintaining equal numbers of males and females and having similar, what evolution would tend to do if you had a skewed ratio from that 50-50 is it would tend to favor the gender, or select for the gender that is not as frequent, because that would mean that they would have increased reproductive opportunities. And so evolution is keeping that 50-50 ratio. This is, you know, end result of that evolution, but the sex ratio at the age of reproduction then is 1-to-1. So males, we tend to have more fertilized male eggs, but they don't, males tend not to survive as well. So the end result is the sex ratio 1-to-1.
Is that a human ratio we're looking at there?
Yeah, these are human ratios. Okay, so then. Section. And then you can go through the next section. Okay.
It's a hypothesis that stood up to scrutiny and evidence.
Yeah, so it's a hypothesis that has lots and lots of evidence to support. So chromosomal theory is a hypothesis. It was a hypothesis at one time. What's the hypothesis here? Basically, what we're trying to figure out, how characteristics are passed down from one generation to the next, and where is this information being stored? And basically, we're saying, okay, it's the chromosome. It's on the chromosome. Did we know that? There were all sorts of, and even like, you know, Charles Darwin had some pretty wacky ideas about how things were inherited and everything else. But what we, in order to transform this hypothesis that the chromosomes were the where our genetic material was being housed into a full-fledged theory, right, full-fledged scientific theory, we had to stand up the test of time. And so we're going to go through some of the experiments that mostly laboratory of a guy named Thomas H. Morgan went through to kind of establish that. What they had to do is they had to, one, select the model system. The model system ends up being our favorite lab system, your software, right? And they needed to look at the meiotic behavior of the chromosomes and see if they could link that, or see if there was concordance between the meiotic behavior of the chromosomes and some of these principles, these patterns of inheritance that Mendel discovered, most notably the principle of segregation and of independent assortment. If you could link those two things together, that would be the first step in establishing, okay, you know, we see these patterns, right, of inheritance on sort of a gross scale, this classical genetics, transmission genetics scale. But then if we can link it to the cellular perspective, we can then say, okay, we can explain these patterns or the behavior of these patterns by linking it to the behavior of the chromosomes. And so that's basically what we needed to do to establish this chromosomal theory of inheritance. And so by 1910, most scientists had suspected the genes were situated on chromosomes just by the general behavior of the chromosomes. We saw that they lined up and that they got separated out and inherited into new cells and things like that. So that wasn't so revolutionary when Morgan came onto the scene. But what needed to happen is we needed to link a mutation, so some phenotypic variation, to morphologically distinguishable chromosomes to really nail down that this is where it's happening. You know, because you can have correlation in lots of things, right? But in order to begin to more firmly establish the causation, you need to do something like that, right? And that's something in science that we're still sort of struggling with. Not science we're struggling, but we're still having a hard time communicating that to the general public. Just yesterday, listening to the radio, and again, it was about vaccines and autism. It was a correlation, and still people were calling into the radio and still saying, well, you know, why the increase in autism, you know, with the increase in vaccines, right? It's a correlation. People still have a hard time saying, okay, whenever people see correlation, they tend to automatically assign causation. And the radio host, Doug Wright, if you're listening to Doug Wright, the radio host, he did an okay job, but he still wasn't, you know, just, there's a big difference between causation and correlation. And so, as scientists, we need to take that further step and better establish that causation. Okay, so, let's see. Okay, so yeah, so what we need to do, what Morgan needed to do is needed to link the mutation to the behavior of the chromosome. So if you're going to do that, one, you'd want to have a system that didn't have very many chromosomes, right? How many chromosomes do Drosophila have that we saw in the slides before?
Four
different kinds. Here they are, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? You have chromosome 2, chromosome 3, chromosome 4, the little pink one, and then your sex chromosomes. And so that was important for the establishment of chromosomal theory is that you had a simple system, not very many chromosomes. A really important thing about it also is that you had a distribution of different genes throughout the different chromosomes, and that you could have recognizable, from a microscopic perspective, recognizable differences between the chromosomes. And so here, if you were to say, okay, I want to be able to follow and link a mutation with a particular chromosome, which chromosome would you want to do that? Which of these is the most distinguishable? Probably four, right? It's the puny one. You might say, okay, you know, it's hard to tell. Could you distinguish pretty easily three from two from three under a microscope? Maybe not. They're pretty similar size, right? Unless you were doing stain and stuff, that, you know, that makes it a little bit more difficult. Could you distinguish four from three? Yeah. Could you distinguish four from two? Yeah. But what would be the problem? Was the downside of selecting four to try to track the behavior of four and link it to a mutation?
Tiny chance of that.
Yeah, there's not very many genes on there, right? In this one, they're not listing any genes. And so you say, okay, well, you know, you go to the lab and you say, well, maybe I'll do two, because we now know, you know, that different, if we think back to our Drosophila lab, what are some of the characteristics that we saw, that we traced? Remember? Vestigial, where's the vestigial wings? Here, chromosome 2. What's another one? Remember strain B? What does strain B have? Oh yeah, which one was it? Or maybe it was strain A. So we had wide-eyed. Where do we see the wide-eyed gene? Mm-hmm. Here. And that was the one that segregated with gender, right? So now this is making sense to us. But where we had the 9331 ratio on, it was vestigial and what? We remember? Nigulosoma? Yeah, ebony, right? Ebony. One is on chromosome 2, one is on chromosome 3. That now makes sense that they're independently assorted. Why? Because they're on different chromosomes. So now we're revisiting these things. We looked at it from that perspective. Now it's making sense from a chromosomal perspective. So these might be easy characteristics to see and distinguish. Ebony, you guys are all pros. Finding ebony flies, you're all pros. Looking at finding residual genes. But the problem is that you might not be able, you know, 100 years ago, under the microscope, so you might have a difficult time distinguishing those. So then, probably, what's the best one to look at? Which ones would you be able to distinguish fairly easily? What's that? Not the characteristic chromosome. Yeah, could you probably, even, you know, as with very limited experience as an undergrad, could you distinguish the X and the Y chromosome? Probably, right? And so that's what they ended up doing. They said, okay, these are easy chromosomes to distinguish. Let's look at the XY chromosomes, follow them through these, you know, transmissional genetics, and then also look for some characteristics that would be easily identifiable. Which in our lab was the characteristic that was probably the easiest to score? Was it the sex cones? Probably not, right? Was it eye color? Yeah, that was easy. Most of you could probably even do that without a microscope, right? So the wide-eyed, it just happens that, okay, they discovered the wide-eyed mutation. They then tracked that wide-eyed mutation and looked at the behavior of the chromosomes. This was the first step in establishing chromosomes as the vehicle for the housing of this genetic material. And so this is basically the sequence in the first experiment that Morgan had to do. So first he discovered a mutant in the laboratory, happened to be a wide-eyed mutant, right? He said, all right, it's good, let's investigate this further. He took the wide-eyed mutant, happened to be, I guess, a male, and he crossed it with the red-eyed female, right? That's kind of what we did too. When he did that, all of the F1 progeny had red eyes. And so he's keeping track of this. Okay, wide-eyed male, red-eyed female, cross them together, you get all red-eyed F1s. You then cross the F1s, and you get all females and half-females that have red eyes. All the females then have red eyes, half-females have red eyes, half-females have white eyes. So now you're getting this pattern, right? Now what do you have to do? You have to link that pattern to the behavior of what? The chromosomes, the X and the Y chromosomes. And so we can kind of do that, right, in retrospect, but you have to think of it from their perspective. perspective, they were doing this, you know, without the advantage of saying, oh, let's just draw these chromosomes up and do the crosses. If we do it, it seems pretty, like, you look at this and you say, okay, here are the data, how do we make sense of the data, you have to, you know, maybe plot down a whole bunch of different things. But what we can do is we can do it from our perspective, we have a little bit of background now. We say, okay, in the parental generation, we have 2X chromosomes, they're red-eyed females, right? White-eyed males. We're now going to assume that this eye-colored gene is on the X chromosome. We have all red-eyed females. We make those two together. What do we get in that next generation? We have a female, right, with a red-eyed gene, wild-type gene, a female with a white-eyed. We have to establish that dominant recessive interaction, right? So all the females have red eyes, all the males have red eyes. This explains that first observation. F1, all red eyes. Does it make sense from the chromosomal perspective? Have we linked it? Yeah, we've done a pretty good job of linking it. So then what does he do? He then breeds the F1s, and we go through and say, okay, all the females were red eyed. That makes sense here, right, from that chromosomal perspective. Half the males are wide eyed, half the males are red eyed. That makes sense. It now makes all sense when we link those two things together. So, what do you think happens? We linked it together. All the scientists said, all right, yeah, there's chromosomal theory, and we never thought about it again. Is that how you do science or not? No, what do you need to do? When in doubt, what do we do?
Sex them,
right. We make, right? And so that's what they did. It says, all right, well, let's, you know, we've got to keep building evidence. We've got to keep building information, building data. And so they took a... F1, red-eyed female, and made it with a white-eyed male. Now, we begin to say, okay, now that we kind of think we know what's going on, it's time we start predicting outcomes, right? If we predict outcomes, we do the maybe, it comes out and more or less how we think it's going to come out. That's now another layer of information, another level of support for that. And so they did that. So they said, okay, let's take the red-eyed F1 females, made it with the white-eyed males. They did that, and they said, okay, here's the red-eyed females, white-eyed males. They predicted the ratios. We can predict those same ratios. What are the ratios that we predict? White-eyed is kind of like a test cross. Corey, second chance, test cross. What's the ratios in the test cross? What's the way they did in lab? 1:1:1:1. That's exactly what they ended up doing. They ended up getting roughly 25% white-eyed male, 25% red-eyed male, 25% white-eyed female, 25% red-eyed female. Okay, it came back pretty much like, all right, cool, there's experiment number two. Now are we ready to say, all right, nail the coffin shut, we now have chromosomal theory? How many of you would be? I'm with you. Maya would, Maya's like, yeah. Okay, so they said, no, we're going to keep doing more experiments. So, you know, we recruited some other undergrads, and they said, all right, let's take white-eyed females and meet them with red-eyed males. So they did that. They got the F1s, they predicted, you know, white-eyed males in the F1s, red-eyed females, they ended up getting that and said, all right, you know, we're getting more confident, but let's do the F1s, let's meet the F1s. When we meet the F1s, we then get that 1:1:1 ratio again, back out. Again, more evidence. Round three, more evidence. Are we ready to do it now? Are we ready to say, all right, we're done with mating flies? Maya, I don't think you do it because you like those flies too much. You just want to keep working with the flies. Okay, so then what do? We say, okay, that's good, but we've done that with the sex chromosomes. Let's look at the behavior of other characteristics. And so let's look at the behavior of, you know, on other chromosomes, the ebony or the vestigial wing. And they did that. And they looked at those behaviors and said, okay, we're doing these matings, we're following the transmission of these, and these aren't behaving, we can't necessarily link those to a particular chromosome, but we can link those to those segregating ratios that we saw in Mendel's pea plants. And so again, saying, okay, now we're expanding out to different characteristics, and again, it begins to support this notion of chromosomal theory. Okay, so then, after all of that, we begin to formulate this hypothesis. We begin to formulate this chromosomal theory of inheritance. I just wanted to throw up an explicit definition of it so that you have it. And a lot of times, it's nice just to have an explicit definition. Chromosomal theory is a unifying theory that Mendel's laws of inheritance may be explained by assuming that genes, this hereditary material, are located on specific sites in chromosomes. That's all chromosomal theory is. All right, now, a show of hands, how many of you are ready to accept chromosomal theory? Should we do more, would you do more experiments? What do you think Morgan did? He did more experiments. And so now it's nice to be able to explain things that happen as we expect them to happen, right? That's one kind of type of evidence to support our theory, but it's even nicer when things happen that we don't expect, and then we can explain the unexpected by chromosomal behavior also. And so that was a whole other area. I know people are looking a little confused, like a time gesture. I'll explain. And so that was the next sort of level that they did. Morgan had a graduate student by the name of C.B. Bridges, who studied non-disjunction. Okay, non-disjunction was where we had exceptions to the rules of inheritance. So if we could leave these exceptions to the rules of inheritance to chromosomal behavior, that's a whole nother category, a whole nother arena of supporting data. And that's exactly what he did. And so what is non-disjunction? Non-disjunction, as we know,
have both copies of the chromosome go to one sperm.
Yeah, so thinking of meiosis, what happens with trisomy 21? That's the result of non-disjunction because, as Elizabeth is saying, what happens in meiosis during anaphase, rather than getting the two chromosomes separating out, right? You get the two copies of the chromosomes migrating to one site and no copies of the chromosomes to the other side. That's non-disjunction. So if we can explain non-disjunction or results of non-disjunction, that would be another sort of layer of proof for chromosomal theory. So here, let's just define non-disjunction, failure of chromosomes to separate during mitosis or meiosis. Here, we have metaphase one, right? In meiosis, going through anaphase one, rather than having the traditional two chromosomes coming up to the top, the two chromosomes coming down to the bottom. Got three going to one side and one going to the other. That gives us an imbalance in the number of chromosomes. In the gametes that then result from this, these upper ones have an added chromosome, right? So it's an N plus one number. If this was humans, this would be, what would this number be? In the gametes, we're looking at gametes, eggs and sperm.
24.
It would be 24. What would the number here down here be?
22.
22. Okay, so in the case of Turner syndrome, that might be resulting from one of these being, if that happened to be an X chromosome, being fertilized. In the case of trisomy 21, this would probably be with fertilization of one of these animals. Okay, so this is what Bridges was studying. He was studying on disjunction when he did experiments. He was, again, doing like all of Morgan's, students did, lots and lots of spending days and days in the fly room, tapping down the vials, transferring flies, etc., etc. He's doing this experiment. Okay, he said, all right, we're going to take white-eyed females, red-eyed males, true breed, right? Takes those, he mates them, what is he going to get out of that? Now that we know a little bit about Drosophila genetics, what?
All red eyes.
What would we do that? Should we write it out?
Two red, two white.
This is our next level of problem. So we can do pun and squares, right?
We can go to X, Y. So wide eye, X, Y, wild type, right? You go Punnett square, what do we expect? Draw it out. Okay, so what do we expect? What's our ratio?
One
now, what are the females going to be? What's this
red.
Female?
Red.
What's
white.
This male? White. So we're going to have all red females, all white males, right? So he does that, he does it a couple times, that happens. But then all of a sudden, occasionally he would get a red-eyed male and a white-eyed female. So how sort of extra mutant flies out of here. It's like, wait, what's going on? Why are we getting these red-eyed males and these white-eyed females? What would you do if you were in that case?
Cross them again.
Maybe cross them again, right? And then look at what's resulting. What else might you do?
Count the chromosomes.
Yeah. You might, you know, do something that Maya doesn't like to do. Kill the fly and look at the chromosomes, right? If he would do that, since he was studying on this junction, this is what he found out. So here, he would look at the chromosomes of the normal, you know, the expected ones, and he'd say, okay, the red-eyed females have 2X chromosomes, that's good, that makes sense. The white-eyed males have an XY chromosome. But then, oh, we got 1 minute left. Okay, so but then when he looked at the ones that were a little bit unexpected, so for instance, the white-eyed male, he looked at the chromosomes, and guess what he found? He found that the white-eyed male had 2X chromosomes and 1Y chromosome. When he looked at red-eyed male, he found that the red-eyed male just had 1X chromosome and no Y chromosome. When he looked at another one of these females that usually die, he still looked at the chromosome and found that it actually had 3X chromosomes. So what's going on here? So not only are we saying, okay, you know, this is a whole another layer of complexity. That tends to be what happens, right? When we start looking at these things, we get other layers of complexity. But what he found, what to your observations, kind of weird about this? The eye color. Is it still the same sort of thing? These have red eyes, right? You have a wild type, you're making the right genes, so that makes sense, right? These have red eyes, right? Have the wild type, that makes sense. These are wide-eyed, you have WW, that makes sense. So that part makes sense, right? So that part, you're actually linking supportive of chromosomal theory. But what's it telling us about the X chromosome and the Y chromosome and about sex determination in Drosophila? How important is the Y chromosome? What's that, Elizabeth?
The Y has no part, it's just how many X's.
Yeah, the Y has really no part in determining sex. It's really the number of X chromosomes. And not even, it's even, if you remember from the fly booklet, it's even a little bit more complicated than that. It's this crazy sort of ratio between the number of X chromosomes and the number of autosomes that give you these different things. But what he found out is, in fact, Y chromosome didn't have anything to do with sex determination. It was necessary for fertility. But by looking at that non-disjunction, you saw the non-disjunction, you saw the behavior of these chromosomes, and you were able to nail it down to these phenotypic, unexpected things happening in the experiment. So again, now, a whole other layer of support for chromosomal theory. Okay, so let's stop there. Are we ready to accept chromosomal theory?
Yeah.
All right, good. Go home. Mendelian principles, right? I saw my hat on. Mendelian principles of segregation, independent assortment, right? Where did that come from? Like, how did we generate that? How did Mendel discover that? What's that, Corey? You just said it too fast. He looked at what kind of genetics was he doing? Was he doing molecular genetics? Classical genetics, transmission genetics. So he was looking at these patterns, he was looking at what we've all looked at a whole bunch of times, the ratios, right? And he said, okay, this makes sense. And so he would probably, you know, in his monastery, wrote it out on a piece of paper or something, symbolically, right? So that's what we've done. In our lab, we did it symbolically. Now, now that we're talking more specifically this chapter about chromosomes, let's look at it from a chromosomal perspective. So we understand the principles of segregation, right? Because we looked at the ratios, and there was this 3-to-1 ratios, and we looked at probability, and we said, okay, that's what we would expect. They're segregating independently. But how does it happen mechanistically? Where is it happening mechanistically? So if we look at the principles of segregation, we go back here to meiosis, right? Segregation and independent assortment is going to be something that we're going to look at during meiosis because we're creating the gametes, right? And then the gametes are fusing, and then the individual organism is growing up and creating more gametes, and then the gametes are fusing, et cetera, et cetera. So where is segregation happening here? Where, if I would say, okay, which phase of meiosis can account for the principle of segregation, what would you say? Where is it happening? Is it happening here in telophase 2, telophase 1, anaphase, metaphase? What's happening? Let's go back and say, okay, what is the principle of segregation? Somebody define it.
It's when it's separated, right?
They're separating. What's separating? What are we talking about?
Two
alleles and a single gene. Yeah. So where is that separation happening here? Is it happening in anaphase 1? Is it happening in anaphase 2, where the sister chromatids are separating out? Corey says 1. Anybody with Corey? Oh, you're saying telophase 1. So telophase 1. So what's separating out here in telophase 1? The or cytokinesis, the individual cells. Where are those alleles? Is this a separate allele from this in the sense of principal segregation? No, it's a duplicated one, right? So here's one allele. So if we were doing it symbolically, right, we would have, okay, big A, little a, and you're going to produce those gametes, right? You're going to have big A, little a gamete, and then it's going to fuse with, let's say, some other gamete from here to form big A, little a. So where is independent, where is segregation happening? It's happening from here to here, right? It's happening where the big A is separated from the little a. Where is that happening there? In anaphase 1. Mm-hmm. And so that's where it's happening. So I just want to give you that perspective. I just want to come back to it and say, okay, now we understand it symbolically, we can do these problems, but on a real mechanistic sense, where is that happening in the cell? And so we're always trying to sort of toggle back and forth between the symbolic, statistical, mathematical perspective, the classical genetics perspective, right, which is that one, the cellular perspective, and eventually, you know, sometimes we do the molecular perspective too. Okay, so the next one, independent assortment. Where is independent assortment happening? So, again, let's do the same thing. Let's define independent assortment. When we talk about independent assortment, what are we talking about? Alleles of the same gene, alleles of different genes. If you remember, you're still just like in this coma, post-exam coma.
Mm-hmm.
I shouldn't have checked.
You shouldn't have what? You shouldn't have checked your score. No, it's just one exam. Oh, so I guess I should mention too, when I do grades, I do it more holistically. So I look at like trajectory. I always look at if somebody is really bombed one exam, stuff like that. I know a lot of times this first exam, the first part exam, people sort of panic. Don't panic. Just be better on the next one. There's a lot of other places you can get points to with lab and everything else. Okay. So don't panic. Okay, so they're talking about
independent assortment.
Independent assortment. Where is that independent assortment happening?
Metaphase.
Metaphase 1. Somebody says metaphase 1 because what's happening in metaphase 1? So in meiosis, they form these tetrads, right? So what's pairing up? Here. You have this gene here, right? The alleles of this gene, this allele, the alleles of this gene, let's say this is chromosome 1, chromosome 2. They're lining up together, right? So how is that lining up happening? It's sort of a random sort of thing, right? In the sense that one, it's pairing with its homologous chromosome, right? So number one is pairing with number one. But you could have in one cell, big A here, little A here, big B here, little B here. In some other cell, right, you could have little A up here, big A here. You could have little B up here, big B here. You can have all of these different combinations. And so the fact that they are lining up sort of in a random fashion with regards to the paternally or maternally inherited chromosome, that gives that independence of that independent assortment, right? If you had two genes on the same chromosome, would you be able to have that same random sort of assortment coming together, or the random pairing of combination of genes? No, right? And that's where you violate independent assortment. Okay, so that's where that's happening. Okay, independent assortment due to random alignment, different chromosomes during metaphase. So just remember that. I just wanted to kind of touch on that so that you could go back and figure out, or just kind of go back and gain a more complete understanding of everything that's going on at these different levels. Okay. So sex-linked genes in humans. Okay. When we talk about sex-linked genes and traits, we've already, kind of talked about it with Drosophila in the fly lab. We've had a few kind of problems with it. Here, this is just a section that we sort of explicitly say, okay, let's deal with sex-linked genes. When we deal with sex-linked genes in humans, the vast majority of the time we're talking about genes that are located on the X chromosome. Why is that? Because the X chromosome seems to be much more important, right? There's a lot more genes on the X chromosome. There's a few on the Y chromosome. We'll talk about a few of them here. But it's usually these conditions that where we see there the disparity between the incidence in males and the incidence in females. That sort of is a red flag for us. We see that, we then say, okay, maybe these traits are sex-linked. There are a couple of classic sex-linked conditions. A lot of times when we're looking at sex-linked conditions, we see the biggest difference or disparity between male and female incidence when they are recessive alleles. One classic one is hemophilia. We've studied hemophilia, sort of, I guess, fortunately or unfortunately for the people, but fortunately for us, hemophilia occurs in high incidences in certain places. Here, this is this is Rasputin. Who's Rasputin?
The advisor to the Russian Tsar.
He was the advisor to the Russian Tsar, Nicholas II, I think. You see, what's the cartoon?
Anastasia.
I was just saying that. Is that where
it's not Disney, from? Though.
Yeah, it's not.
Oh, it's not a Disney?
It's too dark for Disney.
Yeah, it's a little raunchy for Disney. Like, raunchy's the bad word, but,
So he was the advisor to the Tsar Nicholas II. He was a Russian Orthodox priest, kind of a wandering ascetic kind of priest, and he gained significant influence with Tsar Nicholas II by, taking him through. Tsar Nicholas II had a vulnerability. The vulnerability was that his son was a hemophiliac. And so if we look at the incidence of hemophilia, so what is hemophilia? Let's do it quick. There's a couple of different kinds of hemophilia. We're not going to go too much into it, but basically you have a hard time clotting when you have a wound. So if you have a child with hemophilia, it's a hemophiliac, you have to be very, very careful because they can, stuff can happen to them, etc. Christian.
So does that have anything to do with their blood being thinner overall, or is it just the big one?
Well, it has more to do with the ability to clot, not necessarily the viscosity.
So they don't have any less likely to have blood clots inside, an aneurysm.
This is a slide that just shows sort of a simple pathway for blood coagulation. And you can have all of these different factors, right? Here's this sort of cascading step of what your body needs to do in order to patch up a wound, right? And now that, we've kind of been looking at genetics from a molecular cellular level, we can see that, mutation in any one of these could have an effect on the overall cascading outcome or the overall outcome of the inability to form blood clots or coagulation and that. So the two most popular, I'm not going to get into factor 8 and factor 9, these are different kinds of hemophilia. This is hemophilia A, this is hemophilia B. Okay, we're not that interested in sort of how it works, but just understand these are all potential genes where you could have a mutation for, and the end result would be like a kind of hemophilia. Okay. So here, though, for our purposes, this is what we're more interested in. We are interested in a pedigree. So here's an actual pedigree, right? Do you notice any new sort of symbols?
Yeah, there's yellow.
Yeah, so there's yellow. Good.
And pink.
We're going to test you later on with your colorblindness score. So you're off to a good start. So there's yellow. The yellow is that we have a possible hemophilia. And so a lot of times in their historical data, right, there are oftentimes we have good evidence, but we don't know for sure. We've talked about the limitations of human pedigrees, but this is a pretty interesting pedigree. If you look at it, so Rasputin, Russian imperial family, here's our Nicholas II. This is, I think the son was named Nicholas II. Does anyone remember Nicholas II?
I don't think
here are a whole bunch of daughters. The yellow means that they're possible carriers, right? So these are the females. Here, these two in generation 4-2 and 4-3 here, those are sons that were possible carriers that weren't entirely sure. I don't know if they died when they were young or whatever. But if you look at it here, what you see, if you see people that have hemophilia, so not just a carrier, but if you look at only people with hemophilia, what do you see? You kind of can't see. It's kind of hard to tell this red from this red.
Seems like they're all male.
But they're all male, okay? So we were looking at fly eye color when we had this big disparity between male and female incidence. What did that indicate to us? Likely it's sex-linked, right? Like it's a sex-linked character. So you see all male here. And what do you see? You see that so we see that it's male. That sort of indicates that it is recessive, right? Or it indicates that it's probably sex linked. The other thing that we see is that we see in females that we don't have it because it's sex linked. That's what I'm trying to get to before. That probably indicates that it's recessive, right? Because the females only have two X chromosomes. One probably to mask the other. What else do you notice about this? Has anybody ever seen this pedigree before? Do Do you recognize any people with this pedigree?
Is it just the royal name?
Yeah, this is royal. This is for Western European royal family.
At 3-3, what's a?
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. So that was the other thing. So here, because this pedigree is getting kind of funky, right? In order to sort of combine things, right? So here, what do you have? You have a son of Kaiser Wilhelm II, or maybe it's the brother of Kaiser Wilhelm. Who's Kaiser Wilhelm II?
Lived in Germany.
World War I.
All right.
So he was a German
Kaiser.
Oh, yeah,
look at
that.
Caesar, right? So his brother marries his first cousin. And so, in order to show that, I mean, I guess they could have brought this one over here.
I mean,
but
like,
this kind of just loops over there.
I kind of meant from like that 3 to 5, how there's like,
yeah.
How does that 3 go to the 5 when there's like no mating?
Oh, so birth of the Genesis. No, I think because it was outside mating, so this son of Queen Victoria, you know, married a commoner or something.
Like and they were like, don't just open
it.
They didn't want to
put it in
the
center. Just for spacing,
that's funny.
Yeah, so just for spacing. So it gets complicated. So there's a few, you know, sort of new nuances here, because you have to do it kind of for spacing. But you see, okay, here is German, World War II German royal family.
Oh, yes.
What else do you see?
Yeah.
Spanish royal family over here. You have Queen Victoria, Victorian England, over here. Here you have Prince Charles. He's still alive, right?
Yeah.
Mary Prince Di, whatever. Queen Elizabeth II. So it's really striking that they're all so closely related. Right? All of these different, you know.
But they like lucked out on the little bottom English part. They all seem to be good.
Yeah, oh yeah, so all of Charles and their siblings.
Yeah.
Prince Charles very outside, right?
Yeah. They have at least 2 or 3 weeks of our readings, right?
Here?
No, they have Prince Charles, like, him and his siblings, there's a new reading.
Well, but they're pretty, those are pretty distant.
Yeah.
You see how it's, these are like third, fourth cousins.
Yeah.
So it's not too bad. So luckily, whoever this person was, you know, they outbred here.
Germany, that's good.
This one, they outbred at least 1 generation. So that kind of makes you say something.
Can you imagine if you were forced to marry your sister?
Here? Yeah, this would be
interesting. The blood pure.
But again, it's a little bit harder to see on this one.
Different time.
They're probably like, oh, that's fine.
Translate.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay, so hemophilia. Could you then go through and mark down the genotypes here? Now that we can do that, I think we will do it. Yeah, it's going to be. These are the kind of problems we're going to do. But as you can see, it's going to be a little bit easier. Okay.
So what would the difference of an evident carrier be versus the actual hemophilia?
A carrier and somebody with.
Well,
so evident carrier is going in that pedigree is saying, okay, it's probably a female, and they probably have an offspring that has it. And so we're saying, okay, they're a carrier. For our purposes, when we're doing those, the problems, evident carrier, when we assign the carrier, that's the same thing.
Okay, so possible carriers don't know.
Possible carrier, they're not sure. Yeah, and that's all based on sort of. We're not going to. I just wanted to show you that pedigree with those semi familiar.
It's a cool pedigree.
Show you a real one. When you have a problem, and when we have problems in this chapter, it'll be like the world where you're going to assume that they're not a carrier unless there's evidence that they're a carrier, and then you mark it down. Okay, so what are some other sex linked colors? I mean, sex linked trait. Colorblindness. Colorblindness is another sex linked trait. Who knows anybody who's colorblind? Does anybody in here know or not if they are colorblind? Oh, good. Because we're going to have a test. This is this is your chance to redeem yourself.
Oh, yeah. So, if you're colorblind, that's like a lesser status.
You are? Okay, so here, there's a couple of different kinds of colorblind tests. So here,
they turn off the backlight. Can people see the number in here?
Yes.
Or not.
If I can say that number, do I get that number on the exam?
That's your score.
Sweet.
Yeah, that'd be a good one. Yeah. So raise your hand if you cannot, I mean, if you don't want to. Can you not? So there, you can't see it. Anybody else? Okay, so here, the number is 9 here and then 6 here. And so color blindness is a common sexually trait. So that's good. There are also other kinds. So Chris, you thought you were colorblind? So maybe
No, I knew I wasn't.
Does anybody else think they were colorblind?
I knew a friend.
Yeah, there's another different kind of colorblindness. There's sort of a green, there's a red, pink, a green, blue kind of colorblindness.
Kyle Spainhower can't see blues and purples.
Yeah. Kyle Spainhower, really? Yeah, and so usually when you find people that are colorblind, it's usually males. And why is that? Because these pigments or these proteins that we need in our cones that allow our retina to absorb or perceive color are located on the X chromosome. Can't, does that mean that females can't be colorblind? Does anybody know a female is colorblind?
Her and her sister and her dad were all colorblind.
Yeah, so Elizabeth's friend, her sister, and her dad are all colorblind. What else do we know about her mother now? So her mother obviously had to be a carrier.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's fun. I had my stepson was colorblind. And it was made for lots of
years.
Especially in his teenage years when he came in.
Say, I like a name that has a colorblind option. Yeah, I've seen them like an option. It's crazy. I mean, I don't know that. I mean, it alters a lot of the colors to
okay.
cater to that.
Color blindness. What are some other? Well, let's just read it. So, assuming a female carrier marries a man that is not colorblind, what is the probability that she has a colorblind child? Just to get you started, what I usually do if I think, okay, this is a sex-linked problem, I will usually draw it out as X,
zero,
and X, Y, right? And then on the X, I would say, what's that?
Go ahead. Sorry.
So I would say that it's a colorblind female or a carrier female, I'd say wild type, and that's how I keep track of it. That's just how I do it. You're welcome to do it anyway, but it's nice to keep it on those chromosomes. Remind you that it's sexy. Okay, so assuming female carrier marries a male that is not colorblind, with the probability that she has a child that is colorblind? The second one's a little bit more complicated. A female's maternal grandfather is colorblind. She is not colorblind and marries a man that is not colorblind. What is the probability that she has a child that is colorblind? Okay, so try to do both of these in the next 5 minutes. Responses. And we know he's a carrier. Is there any other information in there? So we need to draw it out. How we do it? Well, so we can do X, Y, X carrier, right? So what else? What was the other text? What is? Somebody read the rest of that text.
She is not colorblind and married a man that is not colorblind.
Okay, so you know that he is not colorblind, right? So once you have the pedigree, we can just start filling it in. So you know he is not colorblind, so he is X wild type Y. You know that she is not colorblind, so you know at least she has a wild type, right? So X wild type, right? Mm-hmm. What else did it say?
That's it. Just what is the probability that she has a child that is
colorblind? And so what we have to do now, we have all of these states that we know. Now we have to calculate the probability that this colorblind allele, right, gets passed down through here and eventually ends up in the kid, right? So, okay, so I just wanted to set it up like that. So then, what did you do, Dan?
So then, we have to look at the probability that she inherits XC from an XC allele that she can pass down here.
Yeah, so probability, you're gonna calculate the probability that she is a carrier, right? So in order for her to have a child that is colorblind, she has to be a carrier. Right.
And
in order for her to be a carrier, what?
She has to inherit a copy from up here. And if you do the planet square, it would be 1/4, but you can automatically get rid of half of them because half of them are male, and she's obviously not a male. So if you did the planet square, it was a 1/4 probability, and so you got rid of all the males.
Okay, so the things that have to be satisfied, right? You have to have, she has to be a carrier, right? In order for her to be a carrier, who also has to be a carrier?
Her mom,
right? Do we know if her mom is a carrier?
Yes.
Do we know, this is another genotype, do we actually know that genotype? Because this individual, right, is...
X wild type.
Did we say anything about this individual?
No.
So we're assuming because there is not evidence to the contrary, we assume that it's X wild type. So we know that she is a carrier. So the probability of that is 1, right? So we already know this genotype. So in order for the probability that she is a carrier, right? So let's say mother is a carrier, is what? 1/2, right? Because this individual is a carrier, we know that she will get one of her X chromosomes from this individual, right? And so it's a 1/2 probability that I get that down here. So that equals 1/2. Okay, now given, she's a carrier, now we have to calculate the probability that she will have an offspring that is colorblind. And this is what Dan was saying. We know that it has to be a male. Why? Because the father here has a wild type X chromosome. A wild type is wild type as the X chromosome. So none of the females are going to be colorblind because it's a sex trait. So these are pretty simple probabilities. You just have to throw in that sort of twist of thinking about it in terms of sex and stuff. And so here, if you calculate the probability that the Y will be passed down, so it has to be male, what's that? 1/2. The probability that the allele will be passed down from the female is 1/2. Okay, and so then here, you have the probability in, remember when we do offspring, the 1/2 left 1/2. It's almost the same thing here. It's 1/4. The total probability then becomes 1/8. Everybody see that? So it's not too hard. I mean, if you look at it initially, you just first have to sort of hone your skills, right, on being able to translate those things into, the text into a pedigree. Then go back to the same stuff that you learned in the study for last exam, doing the pedigrees, writing them out, etc. So you want to go through, it's actually nice because it sort of reinforces the stuff you learned last time, and it's encouraging for the students because you feel gets point like, oh yeah, these are really easy. Okay, it's a little more confident about it. Okay, that is, of course, maybe you need to go back to last chapters and hone those skills a little bit more. But then this chapter should be pretty easy. Okay, so let's talk about the Y chromosome. Talk about the X chromosome, let's talk about the Y chromosome. The Y chromosome doesn't have as many genes. There are few X-linked traits, but there are a couple. We'll talk about them. On both the X and Y chromosomes, we have genes that are called pseudo-autosomes. And so even though they're located on the X and Y chromosome, they behave as if they are not sex-linked. So that tells us that they are located on both the X and Y, and sometimes carcinomas do occur between the X and Y chromosomes. If we look at the Y chromosome, we see that there are about 307 genes, and there's over 1,000 on the X chromosome. The X chromosome has a lot more genes. Okay, so key point, we looked at disorders. We're trying to do our new set of problems. I encourage you to go and then try those out. And then just know kind of what the pseudo autosomal genes are. Okay, sex chromosomes and sex determination. In some organisms, chromosomes. So, key point, we looked at disorders. We're trying to do our new set of problems. I encourage you to go and then try those out. And then just know kind of what the pseudo autosomal genes are. Okay, sex chromosomes and sex determination. In some organisms, chromosomes, in particular the sex chromosomes, determine the male and female phenotypes. But really, when we look at it, is it necessarily the chromosome that determines it? Probably not, right? It's probably the product or the genes that are located on the different chromosomes that will determine. Here, in human beings, sex, there's a couple of different. Genes that are involved in sex determination. So here we have our female, our XX, and we have our male, our XY. If we look at the Y chromosome in humans, and I guess we're getting real ahead of ourselves, but in humans, if you are XXY, are you male or female?
Male.
Male, right? So it's sort of, I mean, we're going to get to the sort of gray area.
It's like female characters.
But you have somewhat feminized characteristics, but you're specifically male, okay? If you're Drosophila XXY, you're what?
Female.
Completely female, okay? And so what does this tell us about sex determination in humans as compared to flies and the importance of the Y chromosome? What did we decide in Drosophila? The Y chromosome really wasn't important.
Right.
In the human system, the Y chromosome is important, and that's because there is a gene on the Y chromosome that we call the SRY gene. This is the testis determining factor. That gene produces the testis determining factor. What the testis determining factor does is it interacts with the embryonic gonads in the medulla, and it causes testes to form. Okay. When the testes form, they produce testosterone. We're all familiar with testosterone. That hormone initiates this cascade of developmental changes, and you become phenotypic weak. Now, okay. So really, it's not necessarily the Y chromosome, but it's this SRY gene on the Y chromosome. In the female, the absence of that gene, or the lack of that gene product, the testis determining factor that's produced by this SRY gene, you have the cortex of the gonads develop, and you end up having eventually forming ovaries in the absence of the testosterone, or the testosterone that is not produced. Okay, so that's how sex is being determined. So pretty straightforward, right? We used to think it was XX, XY, or that's kind of what we learned initially. Now it's a little bit more complicated. It's not necessarily the whole presence of that Y chromosome, but it's the presence of a gene on the Y chromosome. Okay. But there are exceptions. In this section, we're going to look at a whole bunch of exceptions. So here you have the SRY gene, but there are cases, for instance, here, where there an individual has two X chromosomes, but phenotypically that individual is female. What's going on here? Here is the normal one, right? Here's the X chromosome, here's the Y chromosome, here's the SRY gene. Here, sometimes we have individuals that are XY, have XY chromosomes, but they are actually phenotypically female. So what's going on? So maybe there's crossing over, maybe there's even mutations going on. But something's happening in that gene. So here, this is good evidence, though, that it's not necessarily the Y chromosome that's causing male, but what?
The gene.
That actual gene. Or here, this gene's missing, the second's missing, the mutation in that. And so you can have people that are phenotypically female that have X and Y chromosomes. Okay, so what does this tell you? Does this tell us that the SRY gene is dominant or recessive?
Dominant.
It'll be dominant, right? Because here, in this X, in here, it overrides what's at the other one. Okay, so a little bit more complicated, right? And the complications continue. Okay, so we have another gene that is located on the X chromosome. This This gene is named after the mutation. It's called the testicular feminization mutation. And what this gene does is it produces testosterone receptors for our cells. And so you need testosterone, right, to develop the male phenotype. If you produce testosterone, you also have to have testosterone receptors on your cells, and the gene that codes for those testosterone receptors are found, is found on the X chromosome. And so here, this is sort of the normal course of events. Here's an X chromosome, here's a Y chromosome, here's the SRY gene, here's the, we call it the TFM gene. The SRY does all the things that it needs to do to basically produce the testosterone. The TFM gene produces what it has to do to produce those cell receptor proteins on all of our cells. And so you get testosterone, you get the testosterone receptors, you get the sort of normal male secondary characteristics. But what happens if you have, this is the wild, it's named after the mutant state, you discovered it based on the mutant state. This is the wild state. What happens if you have that mutant state on your X chromosome? You're not able to produce those testosterone receptors. And so you are XY, if you went in and you looked at your cells and you did a stain, kind of like you did in one of our early labs, you would see that you have an XY chromosome, right? You could even go in and look at the SRY gene, sequence that, you have an SRY gene, you actually produce a whole bunch of testosterone, but you're phenotypically female. The reason is because you have a mutation here, don't produce that testosterone receptor. So even though you're producing testosterone, your cells are not receiving that testosterone and going through this cascade of developmental changes. You produce secondary male characteristics, there's no signal, you end up developing female secondary characteristics.
Are there treatments for this? I mean, that to like create testosterone receptors?
You're talking about a whole bunch of different cells,
yeah.
So it would be difficult to do.
It's fascinating.
Yeah, so it's really crazy. And so here, can we determine gender really, you know, efficiently? Sometimes in lots of cases, yeah, it's pretty easy, right? As you walk across campus, you can do it pretty easy. But there's a lot of cases when it isn't as straightforward. We have a whole suite of conditions that we call androgen insensitivity syndrome. And so we have a lot of cases where we deviate from this clear-cut male-female phenotype and obviously male-female, male-female identity. We'll talk about some specific cases. We'll talk about a South African hurdler here, Caster Semenya, who, I'm not sure exactly what's happened lately, but I think she's able to compete as a female. But this has played out for the last 50 years in Olympic competitions. Okay, we'll talk about that in a second. Okay, so with people that have a complete androgen insensitivity syndrome, they're born looking externally like sort of normal females, right? Internally, though, there is a short blind pouch vagina, no uterus, fallopian tubes, or ovaries, and they have testes embedded in the abdomen. Okay, so here, this is sort of an intermediate case. Complete androgen insensitivity syndrome is usually detected at puberty when the girl should begin to develop if she never menstruates. Many girls with the syndrome have no pubic or armpit hair. Hair without temporal quality, but they're sterile and not come out their children. And so here we have sort of an intermediate sort of phenotype between male and female. Are they females? Are they females? We don't know. I mean, well, we know that they're part of this sort of intersexual group. So here's a group of a bunch of individuals that have that. They've even broken them down into more phenotypic classes. So depending on where they sit between the male and female identity and phenotype, support things like that. And so it's a really, really interesting situation. Here, this is just sort of the what's going on at the cellular level. There's over 300 known mutations in a gene, two polymorphic trinucleotide microsatellites. Microsatellites are these repeat pieces of DNA. what we're finding more and more is, what we're finding is more and more there are a whole bunch of really complex biochemical sort of pathways, a whole bunch of really complex phenotypes. I'm going to post on Canvas that I want you to read for next time, because I'm going to continue to talk about these sort of intermediate states. It's called sex gender testing in the Olympics or something like that. And so there's an article that I want you to read about that. And then we'll continue on Tuesday. We'll keep talking about this intersex stuff. It's really pretty fascinating. We were talking about these intersex situations. We'll talk a little bit more about them in the next section. I sort of alluded to sex determination in Drosophila. The book goes into a lot of detail about sex determination in Drosophila. Don't worry about all of that detail. Basically, just kind of recognize this table, look at the table and say, okay, how is gender determined in Drosophila? Just know that it's determined, one, not by the Y chromosome, right? We looked at that before, by the X chromosome, but specifically by the ratio of the X chromosomes to the auto chromosomes, the autosomes. Okay, so it's kind of weird. So here, this says, X chromosomes, set of auto chromosomes. If you have one X chromosome and you have a set of two autosomes, so basically regular diploid situation, you're male. If you have two X chromosomes and you have two sets of autosomes, right? So we're not talking about these situations with polyploidy. That's what we're talking about. That's what we're going to talk about in the next chapter, and that's what they're getting at down here. Two X chromosomes, just a normal, regular set of autosomes, you're a female. You have 3-to-2 ratio, 3 to the normal, right? You're a metafemale. 4 now, you have an extra set of autosomes, right? You're a metafemale. Here, you see the different combinations. Everything's above 1, right? The set of X to the autosomes, and here it gets even more complicated, get intersex. Here now you have two X chromosomes, but 4 sets of autosomes, you can become a tetraploid male. That's strange, right? Yep. Actually, in this case, then you have 4 X chromosomes, you're a male. Here, 1X with 3, with that extra, triploid situation, you're a metamale. And so there's all sorts of weird, crazy ways of determining it in your software. Don't worry about the specifics of it, just understand. This kind of underscores this idea that I want to communicate, that it's complex up there, and in humans it's complex too. And so, just remember that. Okay, here is just the summary of the thing. I guess it's just starting off new today. Let's just remind ourselves, how is gender? By the question, how is gender determined in humans, you can say a whole bunch of different things, right? By chromosomes XX female, XY male, by the SRY gene on the Y chromosome, by the TDF gene on the X chromosome, etc. You can explain all of this. And that's basically what we're talking about. This is the most important part. This first one is the most important part. Just know about the sex determination in Drosophila. Okay, so what happens? So if we look at, especially in humans and mammals, we're more specifically concerned with this, but what happens when you have an unbalanced situation of sex chromosomes between males and females? In humans, we have females have 2X chromosomes. In males, we have an X and a Y chromosome. You have to accommodate that somehow. And what we see is different organisms have different mechanisms for compensating for the unequal dosage of the X-linked genes. And here are three of... the ways that different animals do it, right? Balance things out. So one way to do this is to cause your X-linked genes in your mammals, because you only have one copy of them, right? And you want to be able to produce the same things as the females for lots of different characteristics, you're going to hyperactivate that X chromosome, or that X, the gene on that X on your X chromosome. So your genes on your X chromosomes in Drosophila are working extra hard as compared to the ones in the females. So the females are still coding for it. You have two copies, so you can code more readily, fast. You can code more, you can produce more product. And so the X chromosomes, or the X gene, the genes on the X chromosomes in Drosophila, where the males have to be super active, right? So that's how you compensate for it. Another way to do it is to inactivate one of the copies of the X-linked genes. In humans, that's what we see happens in mammals, that's what happens in humans. We'll talk specifically about that here in a second. The other one is to down-regulate the X-linked genes in females. Okay, so basically both of the genes on your X chromosomes in the females are still active, but they're down-regulated, so they're not nearly as active. So one is to really make the male genes work extra hard, the other is to make the female genes down here work half as hard, so that in that way you get that compensation. But the one we're more interested in, sort of because humans do that, is the inactivation of the X-linked genes in females. Okay. So this kind of shows you what has to happen. So if we think about it, okay, we're going to inactivate one of the, we're going to inactivate one of the X chromosomes, right? But at a certain point in time, here, so let's just, where should we start? Let's start here. Here's the fertilized zygote. At a certain point in time, right, here, the embryo begins to develop, right, you're going to inactivate the X chromosome, one of the two X chromosomes in your cells. If that was it, that was the end of the story, you would run into complications when the female becomes sexually mature and begins to produce eggs. Because if an inactivated X chromosome ends up in one of the eggs, there's a whole bunch of genes in there that if that egg gets fertilized with a Y chromosome, that organism is not going to have it, it's probably going to spontaneously abort. So what has to happen is you have to have a stage where you inactivate one of the X chromosomes here during the embryological development, and then you have to reactivate the X chromosomes that are in the germline, right, so that when you produce eggs, all of your eggs will have, you know, healthy, happy X chromosomes to fertilize. Okay? So then you reactivate it, it comes here, the male goes through, there's no, it's a normal sort of development in the male. You, sexual reproduction takes place, you fertilize, you're off and running with the cycle. So you need to activate and deactivate at different time points that X chromosome in females. Okay, so if we look at that stage, and I'm not really that interested in exactly when this happens, but just know that during the development of an embryo, of a female, at a certain stage, we'll just say here, it's at this stage, this figure has color-coded the two different X chromosomes. So one X chromosome here is tan, one is dark brown, which one are they saying? Okay, so the dark brown one was the one that was inherited from the father. The light brown one is the one that was inherited from the mother. At a certain point in time, one of these two X chromosomes is going to be deactivated. So here, if we follow this through, and we're kind of color coding it based on that chromosome, but you know, in actuality, you're not necessarily going to have that color coding, right? It's just to show you what happens. At this certain stage, one of the X chromosomes gets deactivated. Say, for instance, you know, we're going to follow the fate of this dark brown cell right here. That cell during the embryological development continues to go through mitosis and divide and divide. But every cell that is downstream of that brown one right there is going to have that same chromosome being activated. And so in this one, in this dark brown one, which one was deactivated?
which are the chromosomes?
Paternal.
Life, the paternal or the maternal? And this one, and so this, well, this is kind of how it works. So in this one, the maternal one, the light brown one is deactivated, the dark brown one is what is the genes on that brown one is the maternally inherited X chromosome, the ones that are being expressed, and the opposite here. And everything down from there. So then if you get, you know, let's say this is, we've had embryology. So, would say, what, 7 weeks, 6 weeks, somewhere on that, this is a human, that's about the stages. If we look at the human embryo at the 6-7 week stage, right, we would see that there, because of this, everything that was downstream from there, so this maybe would be this little clump of brown ones or whatever, right? So you see that there is a distribution of those cells with different expression of the So we call this a mosaic. So this is a mosaic distribution. And if you were to take these little forces, basically what it's saying is, you know, if you were to follow the fate of this cell, you see that they all, that once they're deactivated, right, all of the cells downstream from there, except eventually the cells in the germline cells that get reactivated, all of those will always have that same X chromosome deactivated. And so it's important when we start to look at different genes that are found on the X and the Y chromosome. Okay. So here we see this, and this is probably the most common example, or most people have seen these different kinds of cats, right? This is a tortoiseshell cat, this is a calico cat. If we look at the tortoiseshell cat, what we see is the color of the fur pigment, is located on the X chromosome. So in the tortoiseshell cat, we actually can see that mosaic pattern, because in each of these, in the tan parts right here, right, are cells that have had the X chromosome that's coding for the black fur deactivated. In the black fur part, you have the cells for the gene, or in those cells, you have the X chromosome deactivated that was coding for the brown. And so what has that? So if you have, does anybody in here have a tortoiseshell cat? You ever had a tortoiseshell cat?
I've had tortoise and calicos.
And calicos, okay, so both of them. So here, if you have a tortoiseshell cat, was it female?
Yep.
Was yours female? Yeah, you're most likely, you know, you can impress people and say, oh, look at that cat. I bet that's female. I'm going to go there and flip it over. Most likely it's going to be female. Why? Because the tortoiseshell cat, you know, and you have to make sure that there's other stuff that goes on with the cat color, right? Sure, but you have to have two X chromosomes, right? And what does the genotype of that cat have to be? Has to be heterozygous, right? And has to code for, we'll just say, the tan and the black gene. And so here you go in, and that's been deactivated. So what do you think is happening in the calico cat? How many of you had a calico? You had a calico too? Calico male? Female or female? Yeah, so a female. Anybody had a male calico? Had a male tortoiseshell?
I know of a male
calico,
but
he's not mine. Oh, we'll get back to that. All right. We really thought that was cool. Okay, so here in the calico, what's happening? So you have two different genes that are influencing this. Okay? In a calico, you have the same thing going on that you have in the tortoiseshell, but in addition to that, you have another gene that is coding for basically spots or no spots, or pigment expression or no pigment expression. So, and it happens not to be, it's not X-linked. And so there's another gene that's found on one of your other chromosomes that's basically going to code for being spotted or not being spotted. And so there's two genes involved. And so that's the difference between the calico and the tortoiseshell. And so here, this is the gene, it's called the piebald gene, and we've seen in other animals this is a deer that has kind of that spotted pattern. When we look at it, it's a dominant gene, so you have to, in order to be a calico, so here, with the X chromosome, you have to be heterozygous for the fur color, and then for the king actually that gives that piebaldism. Has anybody seen other animals that are, did you see that white spotting for piebaldism?
Well, I don't know if it's piebald. I've seen like robins, like white robins. They're probably cystic. I don't know if that's the same thing.
Yeah, it might be. Because like, this is very common.
Like white.
White swatches. Yeah. It's a fairly common thing. In mammals, since it's a bird, I'm not sure what I would guess it is. Piebaldism, you see it a lot. And it's a dominant gene. Okay, so you know what's dominant is not necessarily more frequent, right? That's this thing that we're trying to get into your head. A lot of people think dominant means it is high frequency. Not really, because you don't see nearly as many piebald. Okay, and so that ends up being a calico cat. So that's what's required to be a calico cat. There's two genes influencing it. And so you have this interplay between the two genes. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so back into pauses. Well, no, I wasn't talking about it. Okay, so back to Elizabeth's example. She has seen a male. What then has to happen with that male cat? How can a male be calico? Yeah, so we see, and we'll see a little bit more in the next chapter. We see that sometimes we have an imbalance in the number of sex chromosomes. Sometimes we have an imbalance in the number of autosomes, too, like the Down syndrome. And so in order for a calico cat to be male, it has to be XXY. So what has to happen? It has to be XXY. Then what else has to happen? It has to be heterozygous for that color, and then you have to have the deactivation. So it has to, what do we call this in humans, this condition XXY? Klinefelter's is just have one X chromosome. So yeah, Klinefelter's, what usually happens with Klinefelter's, for one, it's going to be fairly rare, right? So, vast majority of your calico cats, 99.99 whatever percent, are going to be female. You have a male calico, it's a pretty rare thing. Not only that, but usually they're sterile. So usually cats with fine colors, humans, same thing, they're usually sterile, but every once in a while you can have a girl. And so you're going now from maybe one in, I don't know, 1,000 that's male, that's already pretty rare. If you have one that is also fertile is probably one of those 30,000 or something like that. So very, very rare. Do you think they're valuable? Do you think that one is fertile or not?
I don't know.
If it is, 5 extra credit points. Give it to me. So I always used to say that, and then I actually looked it up. They're not worth anything. There was one that was like barely more than a regular calico, which I don't know why, because it's such a rare thing, but I guess it's too. To know that it's rare, you have to be too much of a science nerd or something. It's not valuable. Not nearly as valuable as like a white boat or something. Anyway, okay, so that's what's going on with flying skulls. That's what's going on with calicos and tortoiseshell cats. In humans, this deactivated X chromosome is, we actually give it a name. It was given a name based on the guy that discovered it, a Canadian guy named Murray Barr. That's what we call a Barr body. And so a Barr body was one way, when we start looking at the gender testing, that was one way that we would actually say, okay, is this individual male or female? Take some cells from them, right? Stain them, look at those, we just like we did at the first of the semester with the onion cell, you look at it, you can identify fairly easily Barr bodies in the different cells. And so it was a pretty easy test to do, but as we saw earlier, it's not a foolproof test. Okay, so Drosophila. Dog docents, et cetera, just review those things. Okay, so how do we check gender? Has anybody read the intersex Olympic Games or gender testing Olympic Games? How do we check it? Did anybody read those articles about the South African fertilizer when it was happening a few years ago?
I
About the second. Oh. Was a sprinter?
Yeah.
Castor, Semenya?
Yeah.
She wasn't the hurdler? I thought she was hurdler.
No, she was a sprinter.
Oh, okay. So 400 meter sprinter.
And there was another woman on this other girl that had the same thing happen to her, and they took away all of her medals, and now she works for like $3
in a brick. Yeah, so. So this is the thing. And so when you read the other article about this, I think it's called Intersex in the Olympic Games. I mean, this first came out in the 1936 Olympics. So that's a long time ago. So how come we haven't come up with a better way to test gender? Right? How do we check gender? How do you think they check gender in the beginning? I mean, physical appearance. So first they called it, I think in that article, they called it like the nude parade or something like that, where they would actually go and check their gender, just basically their morphology. But what we found and what we found since then is that there is sometimes variation in that. And so these were the two individuals, the two hurdlers. Oh no, maybe these guys were hurdlers. No, I think these were 100 meter sprinters. Whatever. This was, I think this was Stella Walsh and this one is Helen Stevens. They both were American, but I think Helen Stevens was running for sprint, was, running for Poland. And they were pretty fierce competitors. But if you look at this picture and you look at them and we think of them for classical feminine characteristics, classical male characteristics, they look what we call virilized. So it seems like they have some features that we would say are more classical male features. And so neither of them, I think, would change with the other females. They're both really good. They're both really competitive. And I think Stella won. Helen Stevens challenged her. And there's this whole big thing that you'll read about. In the 1936 Olympics, as you can imagine, the newspaper people were as PC as we are now. They nicknamed poor Stella Walsh, Stella the Fella. And there was a big, controversy. This is already a controversial Olympics, right? Does anybody know, Olympic history? Which was what's happened in the 1936 Olympics? Yeah, it was held in Berlin. America had a sprinter, an African-American sprinter, Jesse Owens, who won a whole bunch of medals. Yeah, what's that? Oh yeah, there he is. Yeah, there's Jesse Owens. He won a whole bunch of gold medals, and it was supposed to be this thing, and it ended up being, the showcase for the Nazi Party in Germany, and they banned Jewish athletes and everything. So there's all sorts of controversy already. And this was sort of a sub-controversy going on within them. Okay, so. It gets into how exactly we would test. Now that you've had this section on how gender is determined in humans, do you think you could do a better job of figuring out if a runner was female or male? How would you do it? So Juan, Corey, he's volunteered for just the morphological expectation for examination or whatever. So what would be another one? Bar body, right? Okay, so we are talking about bar body. You could go, you could take some cells and look for bar body. But if they, that goes, this is foolproof. Is it foolproof? No, because what did we talk about at the beginning? Some of those genes, what is it?
The SRY genes.
Yeah, the SRY genes. So, okay, no, we're even more sophisticated. We're going to test for the SRY gene. We can all of a sudden, we can sequence that. Oh, okay, this individual has it, this individual doesn't have it. Then all of a sudden we say, wait a second, here's this. You start having conflicting results. Here's somebody morphologically that's female, but actually has that SRY gene. So then what do we do? What was the explanation for that situation from the first of the testicular feminization mutation, right? They weren't producing those cell surface proteins that would allow that testosterone cascade or or wouldn't allow for testosterone to signal those cells. So this also we say, okay, well, what about that? And what we see is it's really, really complicated. For the most current ones, we see, like with Castor Semenya, we see that actually there's a whole team of people. There's endocrinologists, there's geneticists, and there are even psychologists that go in and say, okay, is this person, does this person mentally identify as a male or female? And so again, even with that, they can't go through to do a good clear-cut way, as is the case with Castor Semenya, where they were like saying question it, then they didn't question it, then they didn't take away her medal, and then said she couldn't compete, etc., etc. Maya?
That's what I was
going to
say, like the article said, even with all the tests, like all the different ones they run, there's still no good, like, perfect way to do it.
Yeah, there's still no foolproof way, there's no silver bullet way of testing it. What we do know, though, and we'll get back to Pat, is that there's never been, everybody kind of fears this thing that somebody's going to try to pretend they're a female and compete with a female. We've never had a case where any of these people that are competing actually identified as males and were trying to, like, fool everybody into doing it.
That was another thing. They said, like, when males overachieve, no one questions them, but when the females overachieve, they can, like, break records, then they all get, like, questioned.
Gender politics, good, alright. Yeah, so exactly. So it's a really interesting thing, and it has lots of ramifications. And it's the point of the matter why we're talking about is it's really, really complex. We really, in some instances, just have a really, really hard time identifying, even at a genetic level, you know, gender, because there's this gray area. It's the same thing. You see this a lot in science. So my PhD I did on species boundaries. In lots and lots of species, 95% of species, it's really easy to tell if one organism is in the same, is the same species as another, but in a whole bunch of cases, it's really, really hard. It's just hard to do it. Why is that? Because nature's complex. As humans, we like to really organize things in these really discrete, concrete categorization classes, etc., etc. And nature does not, oftentimes, does not cooperate with this, and this is it. A really good case, an example of that. And so, there are a whole bunch of other ones, and this is just this is the last slide that we're going to do, then we'll take a break. Or the last couple of slides, last topic we're going to do, then we're going to take a break. There are a lot of situations where same sort of thing is happening, where it's really, really complex. I want to underscore, this is just from Wikipedia, so this is a couple of years ago, so it's probably been even updated, right? But there's a whole bunch of different situations where you get these categories of intersexuality. So for instance, I'll just do a couple of this. Fremont is not just in cows, that's where you have twins, non-identical twins, one a male, one a female, and the female is sort of virilized by being exposed to the male hormones of the other cow that's being developed, and so there's a whole bunch of sort of, so then they come out and they're not quite female and not quite male. You have this progesterone-induced virilization. This was caused by a male hormone by the use of progestin in the 1950s and 60s. These individuals normally have internal and external female anatomy, functional ovaries, and will therefore have menstruations. They develop, however, some male sexual characteristics, secondary characteristics. They frequently have unusually large clitorises. In advanced cases, some children have been initially been misidentified as male. And so here you have not only, you know, it's morphologically you're sort of this intersexual category where you can't necessarily identify it. There's a whole bunch of other kind of crazy ones. Here, this column, it gives you the chromosomes, right? This one, this 5-alpha reductase deficiency. Just go through, I just want you to go through and read these just to kind of understand the complexity of it. This one is, you know, particularly, like, hard to identify as this individual male or female. In this condition, individuals have testes as well as a vagina, labia, but a small penis is capable of ejaculation instead of a clitoris. The penis appears as a clitoris at birth. These individuals, and this is a really kind of, you know, interesting part about it, these individuals are normally raised as girls And so they're being raised as girls, they're identifying as young girls. Then at puberty, their testes descend, their voice deepens, and they often develop male sexual identities at maturation, right? People with this deficiency develop with limited facial hair. And so depending on through the development, it's almost the identity is even changing. And so there's just crazy. It's, you know, there's all of these situations where, you know, this kind of brings home the take-home message from this is... But it's complex, and gender isn't as hard-clad as we sort of initially think or we grow up thinking. Okay, there's a couple other ones. Let's see. I'll just let you go through and read these. So I just want you to go through, read those, just understand kind of the complexity of it. Okay, and that's it.